This is LRBT2, main conclusion, question 22. So we don't actually have an author here. Well, we don't know what they are doing, but we're going to figure out what they have to say. So generations of European history students are being taught that, you know, political assassination caused the First World War. I will say World War I was caused because of a sandwich. Ask me about it later. This generations of people are being taught something. This is a fact. We're just going to take it as true. Without some qualification, however, this teaching is bound to mislead. So we're wondering, okay, how exactly is it bound to mislead? Why is that? We don't, that doesn't stand by itself. We need some more proof. And they say, since the war would not have happened without the treaties and alliances that were already in effect and the military force that was already amassed. So they're saying, if we don't, you know, qualify this idea, or, you know, if we don't clarify, add some more information about political assassination causing the First World War, people are going to be misled when they're learning this. And here's why. You need the treaties and alliances and the military force. Like, that's all of these things together cause the World War. So someone is going to be misled if we don't add this information. And we go on. These were the deeper causes of the war, whereas the assassination was a cause only in a trivial sense. So they're saying all these things, like, we're bound to mislead students because there were deeper causes of the war. It was like the individual spark that happens to ignite a conflagration that was, in the prevailing conditions, inevitable. So basically, that last sentence is reinforcing the previous sentence that there are deeper causes. So it looks like there's an individual spark. It ignites a conflagration. If we use our context clues, ignite a conflagration, you know, if there's a spark and then something gets ignited, we can guess that that's a pretty big ass fire. So, you know, that spark conflagration literally means something that's like burning, like this huge, like I can only think of huge bonfires. Like, I don't know why I just went all the way to like How to Get Away with Murder season one, the bonfire episode. I don't know why. I digress. So basically the flow of this argument is we have, like, you know, what are generations of students being taught. Hey, this is an issue though, because this is not entirely what's going on. It's not just a political assassination. There were deeper causes of the war, and the political assassination was the spark. Yeah, it did cause it, but there were other things in place that made this blow up like a huge bonfire. Okay, so now we're trying to figure out what's the main point. All right, like, what's being supported? What's arguable? It's this idea that without some qualification, the teaching is bound to mislead. If we just stop there, we could be like, maybe, maybe not. Prove it. Forever saying prove it. Our author was like, okay, I'll prove it. Here's why. These are the deeper causes. They've gone ahead and supported their argument. So here we are. We're going to look for something that goes along the lines of that this teaching is bound to mislead if we don't qualify or clarify or just basically explain. So A, the assassination did not cause the war. So we can stop right there. The assassination did cause a war. Our author isn't trying to say they didn't cause it. They're just saying if we don't clarify, it's bound to mislead. We have to say, like, it did technically cause the war because it was the spark, remember? But all this other stuff happens. Let's just get back into A. So it did not cause the war since the assassination was only the last in a chain of events. No. This is wrong for a few reasons. So they were saying that the assassination was the spark that ignites the big fire. So it's not the last in a chain of events. Maybe last in a chain of events leading up to the war, each of which had an equal claim to being called its cause. Well, I don't know about you, but there's like treaties, alliances, already in effect, military force. I guess maybe it is the end of the claim, like the end of the chain of events, but we don't know if these things all caused one another and then that caused the assassination. It's entirely possible that these things are all in place, but they're not connected. It's more kind of like a web rather than a chain. And then bam, I just slapped the table if you can't see me. Bam, this political assassination happens. It's kind of like you light that candle, like the fuse, and then it goes like out into like four like four corners of the web and everything blows up, even though you lit one place on fire? A is not our answer, because there's a couple things. We do think that the assassination caused the war, with qualification. That first part is what's going to make this certainly incorrect. The second part, kind of arguable. It just takes one half of the answer choice to be wrong for us to eliminate it. B, the war was destined to happen. Okay, I don't know if our author would go that far, but let's keep reading. Since the course of history up to that point could not have been altered. Well, we don't know if they're trying to say that. That's a bit strong. Our author is just trying to tell us, hey, hold on. It wasn't just an assassination. It was all these deeper causes too. So get the picture, the whole picture. We don't know if the war was destined to happen, even though it seems like there was a lot of stuff brewing. C, though the statement that the assassination caused the war is true, so our author does agree with that, the term quote-unquote cause more fundamentally applies to the conditions that made it possible for that event to start the war. So basically what C is saying is like, don't say it caused the war by itself. We want to make sure we also take into account that there were other deeper causes. C is looking like a pretty nice answer. Let's keep moving on. D, if the assassination had occurred when it did, but less military force had at the time been amassed. Okay, we don't know anything. Our author doesn't say if there had been less, they're not giving us a bunch of scenarios. So we can stop right there and we would automatically just eliminate this question. But hey, let's keep reading. So they say, if this was the case, if there were less military force when the assassination occurred, the war's outbreak might have been considerably delayed, or the war might not have occurred at all. That's a really, really strong statement. We just don't have enough information to support it. E, though the conditions prevailing at the time the war started made war inevitable, if the war had not been triggered by the assassination, it would not have taken the course with which students of history are familiar. So this one's a little bit tricky. Although the conditions made the war inevitable, we don't know if that our author would actually support that. And then if the war had not been triggered, it would have not taken the course. Well, we also don't know that either. Maybe there was no assassination, but there's something else that made everyone angry. Maybe, I don't know, it's like the whole let them eat cake thing. It's like, what, there's bread in the palace and everyone's hungry? Like that, not an assassination, still started a war. Who knows? But C is gonna be our best answer here. What C does is it really captures this idea like, hey, we need some qualification. Teaching found mislead. There were deeper causes of the war. That's exactly what C is getting at. And so we'll take that as our best answer.